William Morrow and Harper Audio present Seasonal Work, stories by Laura Lippman. Performed by Laura Lippman, Sophie Amoss, Eileen Stevens, Susan Bennett, XC Sands, Jason Culp, George Newbern, Janina Edwards, Jane Oppenheimer, Jesse Vilinsky, Carlotta Brentan, Eva Kaminsky, and Sarah Naughton. This is Laura Lippman. For Molly Simonson, without whom nothing would get done. Part 1. Good morning, Baltimore. Scott Whitman and Mark Shaman.
Seasonal Work, performed by Sophie Amoss. The photographer said she needed everyone to stand next to the minivan. I tried to get out of it. I'm 14 now, although I look younger, and I didn't want my picture in the paper. I was wearing a t-shirt that was tight on me. My bangs were uneven because I cut them out of sheer boredom the other day, and I had a zip between my brows that looked like a third eye. Gary gave me a stern look. He's big on manners, cooperating. It's part of how he's kept this family together. So I stood at the far end, hoping that if I closed my eyes or looked to the side, they might end up cutting me out. They don't need me. I don't fit. One of these things is not like the others. The littles are enough. They're still cute, and they still care. This is the only life they've known. I'm old enough to remember staying in one place, a house with a yard and the possibility of a dog. Never an actual dog, but the promise hung in the air. When you're older, if you show responsibility. I was 6 when those promises were made. And if you ask me, I've shown a lot of responsibility, but there's just no way we'll ever have a dog. You see, my real dad died when I was 6, and then my mom married Gary, and they had Lenny, Wade, and Barrett. Boom, boom, boom. Barrett's a girl, by the way. She was supposed to be a boy, and Mama had the name Rhett picked out. I guess Barrett's okay for a girl's name, especially given how pretty she is. Otherwise, it's not fun having a name that's like a boy's name, let me tell you. She's only 5, but people can't stop looking at her.
My little angel, Gary says,
and I want to tell him to cut it out, but he's right. She looks like something you'd see on a Christmas card, not that we get Christmas cards. It's hard when you have to move every December. Sure enough, when the photographer, a lady, rearranged us, Barrett was in the middle of the photograph, the boys on either side of her. The photographer had to remind Barrett 3 times not to smile. Barrett can't help it. She just lights up, for cameras, for any flicker of attention. The reporter, a man, asked Gary,
"Can you tell me again what was in the minivan?"
Gary looked at the littles.
"Well, it was supposed to be a surprise." "Oh, but..."
The reporter seemed really young, even to me. He was thin and kind of sullen, like he didn't want to be here. Maybe he was one of those people who thought that bad luck was contagious. If it is, then I have to admit, you'd want to stay as far away as possible from my family.
"Daddy?" Barrett said. "Is Santa still coming?"
No one knew what to say to that. Gary gave me a look and I said, "Dad, is it okay if we go in and watch cartoons?"
"That would be great, Kathy."
Gary smiled at me, grateful. This would give him a chance to tell the full story without the littles hearing every detail, which would include a full list of all the things they were never going to get. He got a disability check and decided to splurge on a big Christmas for us, despite being out of work. He would tell the reporter how he hit Best Buy in the mall, the one not too far from the motel where we're staying, the one with an Apple store and a Claire's and a Build-A-Bear. He paid to have everything gift-wrapped because how could he wrap them in secret? The five of us living in just the one room. Well, two if you count the kitchenette, but it's in full view. Anyway, Gary knew better than to leave the gifts in plain sight when he stopped at Target. Even here in the suburbs, you don't take those kinds of chances. But he drives a minivan. What else would you drive with four kids? And you can't really hide stuff in the cargo section. We have a blanket to put over things, but maybe the paper peeked out. Or maybe if you put a blanket over the stuff in your trunk, people know it's worth stealing. Maybe having Texas plates is enough? People in the North really seem to hate Texas. Anyway, as Gary was probably telling the reporter, someone jimmied the lock, and Christmas was gone just that fast. While we were watching television, the kids got hungry. All those damn commercials. How could they not get hungry? How could they not want things all the time? Some people call TV the idiot box, Gary said. But he liked to call it the craven box. He was very proud of that turn of phrase, although I didn't quite get it. When Gary likes a phrase, he can't let go of it. Anyway, I went outside to see if Gary had any change for the vending machines, although I knew he would not be happy to be interrupted. I waited as patiently as I could while he and the reporter talked at the tables where the motel's smokers congregate. Gary used to smoke, but he gave up cigarettes when he realized how much money he was spending.
I did it for you, he said to me and the other kids, but mostly me. I'm really sensitive to smells, and his breath was something horrible.
I stood over to the side, stamping my feet, exhaling as if I were having my own cig break. It wasn't that cold for December. I've known colder, and I've known warmer. Last year this time, we were up in Cooperstown, but Gary decided that was too small. A year before that, it was Phoenix, but that was too big. He's like Goldilocks, I guess. He said Baltimore looked to be just right. He said Baltimore would be our best place yet. He says that every year, wherever we are. Gary was saying,
I pick up odd jobs where I can. I was a long-haul trucker, but obviously I can't do that anymore. It's hard. I'm a man. I have pride. But I need to live somewhere we can get benefits. We started the school year in Texas, but there's just no help there. Someone told me Maryland was a nice place, so we decided to try it out. It was supposed to be a new start for the new year. Well, it's still a new start. We're starting from rock bottom, but that doesn't mean we can't climb to the top of the rock pile.
The reporter was writing everything down, his eyes on his pad. I coughed to get Gary's attention. I'm sorry, Dad, but it's the kids, I said. They're hungry, and I thought if I could just get some stuff from the vending machine to tide us over until dinner.
Don't you have a kitchenette here? The reporter asked. How do you feed these kids anyway? We do have a little kitchen, Gary said. But I'm not ashamed to say that we go to soup kitchens, food pantries, wherever we can get a little help.
He began digging through his pockets, but I knew he wasn't going to come up with anything. The reporter just kept scribbling in his pad, and my face burned at the thought of the words he was writing there. He searched his pockets, but couldn't even find enough spare change for a bag of chips. The photographer lady handed me five $1 bills.
You shouldn't do that, the reporter man said to her. You're becoming part of the story. That's unethical.
She ignored him. What's the thing you'd most like to see under the tree on Christmas Day? Books, I said. I love to read. And maybe a locket. Her kindness was hard. The kindness was always the hardest part. I gulped and took her money.
Where are your manners, Kathy?
As I said, Gary was particular about manners. Sorry, Dad, I mumbled. Thank you. To the lady, scared I would burst into tears if I tried to say much more. We went to the food court at the mall, had Chick-fil-A for dinner, looked at all the happy people with packages. Gary let us window shop for 15 minutes each. The boys picked the toy store, Barrett wanted to pretend she was going to buy diamonds, and I went to the bookstore, to the children's section, although I'm too big for kids' books. Back in Texas, I had the whole series of Oz books, and the Betsy Tacy books, and the Harry Potter books, and some old books of my mom's, about kids who kept finding magic things, a coin, a lake, a book, a well. Once upon a time, as they say, a long time ago, in a place far, far away.
Tomorrow will be better, Gary said.
What else could he say? He had to believe that. He had to say that. We went to bed. All four of us kids slept in one bed when we stayed in motels, and I didn't mind, actually. They huddled against me like puppies. It was one of the few times I felt happy. When my brothers and my sister were curled up next to me, I would fall asleep running my fingers through Barrett's hair, her breath hot and wet on my shoulder. I didn't pray, not exactly, but I looked up at the ceiling and promised God that I would always take care of them best that I could. Tomorrow wasn't better, not at first. We picked up a newspaper, and there we were on page 3. I was in the photograph, and they said the thing I said, about wanting books and a locket. I looked awful, but not awful enough for them to cut me out. The littles were adorable, though, even with their sad faces. I keep thinking that someone's going to see Barrett one day and say, she should be a model, or an actress or something. She's cuter than any kid I've ever seen in a commercial. But that sort of thing probably couldn't happen in Baltimore. I guess we would have to be in California or New York, and we're never going to try those places. Too big, too expensive. The paper didn't say exactly where we were staying, just that it was a motel in Towson, which I guess is part of Baltimore. We passed the morning feeling glum. It was Christmas Eve, and we were out of step with the world. Everyone else seemed excited and happy, full of anticipation. The temperature had dropped overnight, and there was snow in the forecast. We'd never seen a white Christmas, not even in Cooperstown. But what does snow matter if you don't have a sled? Heck, we didn't even have mittens. Gary had said to leave those behind in Cooperstown. He said he would never make that mistake again, picking a place so cold.
Cold town, cold hearts, he said.
Then, about 11 a.m., things finally began to go crazy. It turned out that the reporter didn't start work until 10 a.m., and when he did, his voicemail was full of people wanting to help us. A television station came and talked to Gary live for the noon news. After that, people started calling the motel, and stuff just began arriving like magic. Food and presents and gift cards, lots and lots of gift cards. Also some checks, but those were never as exciting, and even some cash, which was Gary's favorite. People couldn't give us enough. There were 4 tablets, 1 for each kid. Not iPads, but still pretty nice. An Xbox. Although we couldn't figure out how to hook it up to the motel television. Not that we got around to taking it out of the box. There was just so much to look at. A huge box of books from a store called Women and Children First, which I thought was a funny name. We went back to the mall, got some new clothes, and the photographer returned, took a photo of us in our new clothes, sitting down to the Christmas Eve dinner Dad had managed to fix in the little kitchenette. The chicken and sides were from Boston Market, but he put them on plates and made sure we said grace. We always said grace on Christmas Eve.
What do you think, kids? Our worst Christmas has turned into our best Christmas. As Anne Frank said, people are fundamentally good at heart.
I wasn't sure it was our best Christmas. I thought Baton Rouge was better, and I had memories of Christmas when it was just Mama and me and my real dad. But there was no point in arguing with Gary. Barrett raised her fork high, a piece of chicken stuck on its tines, looking for all the world like Cindy Lou Who. That's another book I had in Texas, the one about the Grinch. As soon as the photographer left, Gary told us to go through the gifts. We knew the drill. We could each pick one thing to keep, but not the electronics, because they were too valuable. It was hard to say goodbye to those tablets and the Xbox, but he was right. They were worth too much money. Anyway, Barrett picked a doll that was almost as pretty as she was, while Wade and Linny chose toy trucks. It was hard to pick between the books and the locket, but the locket was forever, whereas a book would get used up after a while. I was worried Gary was going to say that the locket was too valuable to keep, but he inspected it, nodding, and said,
"Filigree."
I didn't know what that meant, but I knew it was something that wasn't quite good enough. I could imagine him looking at me one day and saying just that, "Filigree." I was filigree, and Barrett was pure gold. I didn't mind. She was his real daughter, after all. I wanted him to treat her good, to think of her as something far more precious than me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.